sorry about that.
But if we are the body, why are
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning to all of you here. Good morning to all of you who are joining us online. We are glad that you're here, however you are here today. I'm going to have some announcements just prior to the sermon here in a little bit. We'll have a special presentation here in just a few moments, but let me open us, if I could, with a word of prayer. Dear God, we thank you so much for this day to worship. God, we thank you for the rain. It's sometimes inconvenient for us, but we need it. And God, we thank you for the folks that are here in this sanctuary. We thank you for the folks that are joining us online. We thank you for the folks that are going to watch us later. God, we just pray that you send your Holy Spirit down in this place. God, that you'd open our hearts and our minds to your word and to your presence. And God, that you would help us to be your church, your body, in the world. All this we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let's continue praising His name.
There's a peace I've come to know. Thank you.
continue to bless us.
Let us sing for joy, let us shout aloud to our King.
third graders, if during the children's sermon they can come up, and we'll be ready as soon as it's over to give your Bibles.
Thank you
for all the churches
and people that are a part of your church.
That are a part of your church.
Help all of us.
Together.
To share your good news.
To share your good news.
With others.
Amen.
Thanks for joining us this week, and we will catch you back, same time, same place, next week. Bye. Okay. So you can tell that we have been in a pandemic for a while when the kids just naturally social distance themselves. I want to thank you guys for being so patient. Some of you have been patient. Some have been reminding me since this fall that we haven't done third grade Bible. But we thought that we could safely do it now, and we think it's super important for you guys to have some of your own Bible in your hand. So we have lots of opportunities in our lives that we celebrate things, birthdays and big events in your life. And when I think about the third grade Bible, that's one of the things that I think about is celebrating, and it is a big deal. Because my hope is that today when you take this Bible home, it doesn't just find a spot underneath of your bed or on your bookshelf or somewhere else around your house. But my hope is that you will open up this Bible and that you'll read the Word of God, because we know what we have learned for a long time in Sunday school and things is that this is the Word of God. And this is the guidepost to what we're going to do in our life. So if you have a question or you have something that you're scared of, the Bible is a great place to find those answers. So when you get these in a minute, I hope that you'll open them and seek out maybe some of your favorite Bible stories or verses. But I've also highlighted 10 verses in here, so that'll be one of your jobs, is to find the 10 verses that I highlighted. And they're verses that I think could be important to your life and are probably important to a lot of people out here. But I want you to also find verses of your own that you really like and that are important to you. And if there's questions that you have, I want you to remember that we are all your Wesley Church family, just like we were talking about the universal church. Within this church, it's not just your family, but we all of us here care for you and really care for the person that God's created you to be, and we hope that this Bible can be a building block to who that person is. So, usually I ask parents to come up, but I figured distancing and things like that, so for a parent out there, we thank you, and we hope that we can continue to do ministry with you together, and that you'll encourage your kids to read their Bibles at home, and that you'll help them to do that. All right, so, are you ready? Okay. All right, I have one for Elise Baker. Do you want to stand up? You should stand up so everybody can see you. Give her a round of applause. Okay. And we have one for Tom Hall. As I was getting these ready, so I was ready. So we have all these. They tell us who we are as your people. They tell us that we belong to one another, for we are your people. We rejoice in this step in their journey with you. We pray that you will guide them, their families, and us as the congregation of Wesley to help them use these Bibles in their homes, Sunday school classes, and worship experiences. We will learn together and grow together in our love for your word and everlasting faithfulness. Amen. Thanks, guys.
Thank you, Sonia. Thank you, kids. Thank you, church and parents, for raising up kids that will love God's Word. I just want to make a few announcements this morning. First of all, we are back in our Creed study this week and next week. We'll be continuing with our small groups in person Wednesday night at 6 o'clock and on Zoom at 6:30 this week and next week. Stay tuned, though. There may be a schedule change for the 21st, so just be aware of that if you're a part of the Wednesday night groups, that we may need to make a shift. You'll hear about that probably Wednesday night when you come. I want to remind you that there is a place to receive your offering as you leave today, and we appreciate your generosity. We also appreciate the generosity of those who are online, sending those in or giving online. I do want to draw your attention to also to our Lent offering projects. There's a display on the back table back there, an opportunity to give to those projects. Also, the new upper rooms are in for May, June, July. Yeah, they're in. You can pick them up today at the back table if you use those. Now let us pray. Dear God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our Rock and our Redeemer. Amen. Well, today we resume our Creed series and look at the phrases, I believe in the Holy Catholic Church and the communion of the saints. So we're going to talk about the church today, but real quick right off the bat, so we're going to kind of lay a foundation of a definition of the church, what the church is, what the church does, and how we're to be a part of it. But the first thing we need to get straight right off the bat is that the church is built by Christ, and it will endure forever. In Matthew 16:18, Jesus says to Peter, you are the rock, and upon this rock, upon your faith, upon your leadership, upon the profession of faith that you've made, and the people like you have made, and the people that are going to make throughout history, through the teaching of the church, upon this rock, I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. So, Jesus builds the church. The church is built by Jesus. It's not built by us. Yes, it has some of the trappings of human organization, and there is human effort and human labor involved, but the church is built by Christ, and here's another thing, it belongs to Christ. The church does not belong to its members. The church belongs to its Lord. Let me say that again. The church does not belong to its members. The church belongs to its Lord. We're not in charge. Now, we borrow sometimes the mechanisms of human organization. We borrow sometimes the mechanisms of democracy. But we're not really trying to get at what we want. We're trying to get at what God wants for the church. Also, notice that the church, and we're going to learn the difference between church and churches here in a minute, or that's going to build throughout the sermon. The church will last forever. Churches will come and go. Right? Churches, like Wesley, we showed up on the scene at a certain period in history, and unless Jesus comes back first in a certain period of history, we will be no more as a local church. Churches come and go. Sometimes churches go because they've accomplished their mission. I have been in small towns, and I've told churches this. I've been in small towns where there's not a town there anymore, but there's still a church. And they start feeling sorry for themselves. And I'm like, no, you've accomplished your mission. There was a community here, and you served that community, and you evangelized that community. You shared the gospel with that community. You helped that community. And now the community's not here. Mission accomplished. And so sometimes churches cease to exist because they've accomplished their mission, but sometimes churches cease to exist because they've abandoned their mission. They've stopped being the church. Now, they've sometimes carried on for decades of being a social outlet, being a hobby for are some folks in the community who kind of like the idea of having a place to go and doing some things, but they abandoned their mission and very quickly, because it wasn't a church anymore, it stopped being a church, and so it ceased to exist. But churches come and go, the church is forever. So the church, the Apostles' Creed introduces what we call marks of the church, introduces two of them. I want to expand that out and use the marks of the church that are used in the longer version of the Creed, the Nicene Creed. And so the Nicene Creed, the church is referred to as one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. And so these four things are known as the marks of the church. And so let's take them one at a time. The church is one. The church is one. In John 17, 21, Jesus prayed that his disciples and all those who would come to faith in him through their teaching would be one. I'm here to tell you that appearances to the contrary, Jesus' prayer was in fact answered. I'm here to tell you today that despite appearances to the contrary, there is one church. There is one church. How many churches are there?
One.
There is one church. That one church is made up of lots of churches. Now, how many churches are there? I don't know. I mean, your guess is as good as mine. And we're a church here at Wesley, and our Presbyterian brothers and sisters across the street, there are churches. In Calvary and Cross County, there's a church. In St. Mary Matthias, those are churches. Those churches belong to many different denominations, and we can be tricked into thinking that that's a bad thing. Right? How many of you have tricked yourself into thinking that's a bad thing? But I think it's a good thing. Because I think people are different. People are different, communities are different, people have different needs, people have different ways of worshiping. And so the churches and the denominations to which the churches belong emerge because of different worship styles, different methods of human organization, different missional priorities and emphases. Quite frankly, I think it's awesome. I think it's awesome, that is, when we can admit that and belong. It isn't quite so awesome when we try to compete, right? I don't want to be a Methodist that converts Roman Catholics. I don't think there's kingdom building to be had there. There's plenty of people out there that don't know Jesus, that don't belong to any church, that we can all get by just fine. I was talking to a, this is just yesterday, I was talking to a Palestinian Christian, right? I want that term to lay on your mind. A Palestinian Christian, a person who grew up in Palestine as a believer in Jesus Christ. And we were talking about this denominational thing. And he said, you know, over in Palestine and Israel, you know, we have Catholics, we have a couple different versions of Orthodox, we have a couple different bodies of Protestants, but we don't care about that stuff because we're all Christians. And I said, yes, and over there, you guys can't afford to fight with each other. Right? We can kind of get by with that here in America, but in other places, Christians cannot afford to fight with each other. So the church is one. One church made up of many churches, and that can be a beautiful thing if we let it. The church is holy. The church is holy. 1 Peter 2:9 says, but you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's special possession, that you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his wonderful light. We're accustomed to thinking about, and particularly as Methodists, we're accustomed to thinking about being holy as being good. like as individuals, that kind of personal holiness, that we're good people. There's a list of things that we do, there's a list of things that we don't do, or at least we try not to. That's usually what we think of as holy. And we should, because that's part of it. And we should be, you know, we should be doing the things we should do and not doing the things that we shouldn't do. But when we're referring to the church, we're not necessarily talking about the church being good so much, although we should be good, as the church being special. Set apart is actually what the word holy means. Set apart for God's purposes. That is, the church has a particular purpose, and that is to do the will of and bring glory to God. And so everything that we do here as a church should be the will of God and bring glory to God. I use illustrations. So we've got the altar table up here. And you wouldn't carry the altar table across the street to the youth center and play ping pong on it. You just wouldn't do that. Why? Because it's special. Because it's holy. And so everything we do as the church, everything we do, frankly, as individual Christians, should bring glory to God and be the will of God. We should be set aside for God's purpose. I was in one church that it was suggested at one point that they do a rummage sale, and they decided, no, we're not going to do a rummage sale in the church building. Now, I have nothing against that, and opinions vary, right? But they're on the right track of thinking about what it means that the church is holy, that it's set apart, that it's special. So the church is one, the church is holy, the church is Catholic or universal. This has been a stumbling block here in the Creed series. Sonia addressed it beautifully in the children's sermon. And it's probably been the biggest question I've been asked. Why do we say we're Catholic? Well, because we are, right? We're not Roman Catholic, right? There is a Roman Catholic church here in Muscatine, St. Mary Matthias. But you could also say that they're Roman Catholic and we're Methodist Catholic. We could say that there's Baptist Catholics and Presbyterian Catholics and Lutheran Catholics. So because we're all part of this one universal church, and that goes back to the oneness of the church, that we're all in this together, even if we are gathering in different spaces at different times in different ways. We are part of one universal church, but it also includes all believers across time and space in what we call the communion of the saints. Hebrews 12:1 says, therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles. And so we talk about this cloud of witnesses, and that is all the believers in heaven. All the believers in heaven are still part of the same church that we're a part of, because the church is universal. It spans time and space. And so the saints are there, or more appropriately, the saints are here with us this morning. Those who have gone before us are still in church with us, because the church is universal. The final mark of the church is apostolic. That means it follows in the teaching of the apostles. Right? Jesus left the apostles with teaching authority. He says in the Gospel of John that there are things that he left unsaid that he's going to leave for the apostles to teach through the power of the Holy Spirit. Right? So you can't take Jesus and ignore Peter. You can't take Jesus and ignore Paul. Right? The church comes down through history. One of the easiest ways to tell that you're in the wrong place in terms of a church, and let me just say that there are places that call themselves churches, that call themselves Christian, that are not. That shouldn't surprise you. We live in a religious free market. But one of the ways that you can tell is if that church has disconnected itself from the great tradition of the church, from the history of the church, from things like the creeds, from the teaching of the apostles, from the teaching of the early church. If you go to a church and they've disconnected themselves from that, you're probably in the wrong place. If they say, hey, you know, back in 1937, you know, Brother Billy Bob, he found something in his Bible, and he found out that the churches, they've just gotten this wrong for 2,000 years. The church has just been wrong. They missed this verse, and we've got the correct teaching. We've got the correct interpretation. Yeah, you're not smarter than the Bible, and you're not smarter than the apostles. You're not smarter than the history of the church. If you stumble across something in your Bible and think, I wonder what this means, I guarantee you somebody's figured it out before you. I guarantee you somebody's figured it out before you. I promise. Without the apostolicity of the church, I say that 5 times fast. Without the apostolicity of the church, you know, we handed out these Bibles. I want you to imagine if somebody just handed these books to these third graders and said, good luck. Right? That's insane. Because we need a community of faith. We need a community of faith that's connected to the history of the church to help us understand what the Bible says and how to live it out. That's the apostolicity of the church. Yeah, our connection to history. Well, that's the 4 marks of the church, but I want to say some more things. The church is essential. Now, I mean that with the full force and weight that the coronavirus pandemic has given to the word essential. So I'll say that again. The church is essential. Try again. The church is essential. Thank you. All right, gotta pay for it. So that is, it's not optional. That's the opposite of essential. It's optional. It's not optional. It's not something you can just give up. It's not something you can just lay aside. It's something that's needed. And so oftentimes you'll hear people say really dumb things like,
well, I don't have to be a guy to a church to be a Christian.
I just need my Bible, just me and Jesus. Right? That's a violation of the apostolicity of the church, by the way. That just me and Jesus, just me and my Bible. You're already outside of the church because you violated one of the 4 marks of the church, the apostolicity of the church. I like saying that word. So, not just me and Jesus, not just me and my Bible, not just me at the fishing hole, not just me at the golf course, not just me in my garden. If you connect with God in those ways during the week, awesome. Come to church on Sunday. Do I have a verse for that? So this is, I had, and I didn't change your mind, by the way. It's amazing how many people will say, well, show me that in the Bible and you still don't change your mind. Where does it say in the Bible I have to go to church? Where does it say in the Bible I have to go to church? Yeah. Answer, Hebrews 10, 24 and 25. And let us consider how we may spur one another on to love and good deeds. The King James Version says provoke. Right? That's what we do in church, we provoke one another. So I hope I'm provoking you today. Not giving up meeting together, as is a habit of some. So here, the Bible, the ink's not even dry on the Bible yet, right? The Bible's not even done. Right? We're still in the first century, and people are already like, I don't need to go to church, right? So let us not give up meeting together, as is a habit of some. But encouraging one another and all the more as you see the day approaching. So the church is essential. Right? Now, we've learned to do it in different kinds of ways, at least partially, to provide that connection, or at least some connection in the situation we live in, but it is essential. The church has a mission that is, we've got a job to do. We've got a reason for being here. It's not just about us getting together because we enjoy each other's company and we like the music and, you know, we have a mission. Now, the mission of the church has been defined in various ways. It's one of those things that we can kind of adapt to our current language and our culture. But the mission comes from Matthew 28:18-20. Then Jesus came to them and said, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always, even to the very end of the age." So it's Matthew 28. I want to just kind of walk through some history for you, some quotes. The next one I want to quote is from the Articles of Religion of the United Methodist Church, which came to us from the Church of England through John Wesley. At least this article did. So this is probably from the 1500s. "The visible church of Christ is a congregation of faithful people in which the pure word of God is preached and the sacraments duly administered according to Christ's ordinance in all those things that are necessary and requisite for the same." Kind of sounds like the 1500s, doesn't it? The next one is the Confession of Faith of the Evangelical United Brethren Church. For those of you who don't know or don't remember, the Evangelical United Brethren Church merged with the Methodist Church and formed the United Methodist Church back in 1968. This article from their Confession of Faith comes from the early 20th century, pretty soon before our merger, actually. "We believe the Christian Church is the community of all true believers under the Lordship of Christ. We believe it is one, holy, Catholic, and apostolic," that's the four marks of the church. "It is a redemptive fellowship in which the word of God is preached by people divinely called, and the sacraments are duly administered according to Christ's own appointment. Under the discipline of the Holy Spirit, the church exists for the maintenance of worship, the edification of believers, and the redemption of the world." Now, this is why I say that we can only partially be the church virtually. We're glad you're joining us virtually. We hope you continue to do so if that's a need that you have. But we can only partially be the church virtually. Because to be the church, we have to gather. And it's not just preaching. It's not just the stuff I'm saying. It's also the lived out, embodied, physical sacraments that we participate in that connect us together in a physical way. Which is why we can't. There's some things we can't do virtually and be the church. And so I'll update you a little farther. This is actually the mission of the United Methodist Church. This is our current language. Currently, the mission of the United Methodist Church, and you may know it, is to make disciples of Jesus Christ for the transformation of the world. Don't get it twisted, as the kids say. Or used to say, I'm old. But don't get twisted. Right? The mission of the church is not to transform the world. Right? You might go places and you might get a sense of, gee, this church is doing a lot of good stuff. We're supposed to do good stuff, but doing good stuff is not our mission. Feeding the hungry is not our mission. Clothing the naked is not our mission. That's the stuff we're supposed to do as an extension of our mission. But our mission is to make disciples of Jesus Christ. And when we make disciples of Jesus Christ, those disciples will transform the world. Some Methodist churches get it flipped. They try to make disciples by transforming the world, and that simply doesn't work. It's backwards. I can remember in kindergarten, I read a book, or a book was read to me, called Pickles the Fire Cat. Anybody remember Pickles the Fire Cat? Nobody? Somebody. A couple people remember Pickles the Fire Cat. And you would get the sense, if you were a kindergartner, that the mission of the fire department was to get cats out of trees. Is that the mission of the fire department? Absolutely not. Absolutely not. I mean, I'm sure they do that. Probably they don't, actually. I don't know. But that's not their mission. Just like the mission of the church, these things that we do, that we call missions, aren't our mission. They're our mission, instead of the things that we do, but they're not our mission. Our mission is to make disciples for the transformation of the world. And so your next question is, Pastor Brian, how do we make disciples? Is that your next question? How do we make disciples? I'm glad you asked. Wesley Church, has a discipleship pathway and core values, and you all know what they are. Let's say them together. Experiencing grace, exploring truth, expressing love. See, we believe disciples are made by first experiencing God in worship, God's grace in worship, by exploring the truth in God's word, and then by expressing love in service to the community. That's the transforming the world part. That's the making disciples for the transformation of the world. You should also know, but maybe you don't as well, because we don't drive it home as much, Wesley also has a mission and a focus for our ministry efforts. That is to say, there are thousands of things that we can do in our community to express our love. There are thousands of things that we can do in our community to express our love and help people. But you know what? If we tried to do 1,000 things, we wouldn't do any of them well. And so we've chosen a focus, and we've chosen a vision. And our vision is to transform lives through hands-on ministries with children and families in need. So we have a focus, hands-on. Not just sending money, although we want you to send money, but we're trying to get people engaged in ministry in our community. I know I'm going long today, and I apologize. I'm almost done, I promise. But I've got something stuck in my craw, right? Have since the very beginning of the pandemic. Does anybody mind if I empty my craw here today? I would get the question, and this would have been going back to last late spring, early summer. I would get the question, are we having church this week? That question sticks in my craw for a couple of reasons. First reason is, let's take the word church out of there, because we'll define that again in a minute. So the question is, actually, are we having worship this week? That's the question. And I want to tell you that this church, this staff, has provided the worship opportunity every single Sunday for a year and a half. We've offered a worship opportunity, a corporate worship opportunity, every single Sunday by whatever means we had available to us for a year and a half. And to suggest that we weren't, because we were working our rear ends off, right? And to suggest that we weren't, or that somehow, wasn't real, is quite frankly hurtful to myself and our staff. I tell you that in pastoral love. So yes, we had worship every Sunday. We didn't miss one. If you did, sorry. Secondly, since weekly worship, you also are supposed to always be doing worship every day at home, and I hope the pandemic has led you to more of that. But then let's get back to the idea of church. You see, church is not something we do. Church is not an event we attend. It's not a place that we go. Church is people. Christians don't go to church. We are the church. You cannot be a Christian without being part of the body of Christ. Now, your attendance and participation in a particular church might vary, and that's sad. But trust me, you are a member of the church if you are a believer in Jesus Christ. And I believe that there are many gifts that COVID has given the church. I believe that. I believe there are many gifts that COVID has given the church. One of them is the things that we've learned in how to do ministry, how to utilize technology to at least partially connect us. But I also believe that one of the things that COVID will reveal by the time we're done is who the real believers are and who has just been along for the ride. That'll be a painful lesson, for sure, but one we need to learn. You see, the church is an organism, not an organization. The church is an organism, it's a living thing, not an organization, although we try to be organized and sometimes people will tell me, oh, I don't like organized religion. I'm like, awesome, come to Wesley. We do try to be organized, though. But the church is not an organization. The church is not a place. Although we have a beautiful place, and we try very hard to be good stewards of it and take care of it, but the church is not a place. The church is not an event. We do have events. Worship services, small group meetings, community activities when we can. And we try to plan those carefully in ways that are beneficial and glorifying to God. But the church is not an event. It is a family. And you would never ask somebody, are we having family this week? No. Because family, you go to family events, you do family things, you get together with family, but family is not something you do, it's just something you are. We don't go to church. We are the church. And so I give you Paul's words. Let us not give up meeting together. We need each other. Let us pray. Dear God, we thank you for this church. We thank you for our ministries, our in-person ministries, our online ministries, the struggles and the lessons that we've learned over this pandemic. God, we thank you for our people that have been wonderful and supportive and generous and patient and kind. God, we pray that you would continue to bless us and continue to restore us and continue to help us to carry on ministry. God, we pray for our church. We pray that you bless us and help us to grow and prosper. Help us to worship and serve you in spirit and in truth and serve the world in your name. God, we pray for the whole body of Christ throughout the world, all of your faithful people in every nation and denomination. And God, we pray for the church that is persecuted throughout the world. We pray for the United Methodist Church. We pray for this annual conference and our mission board in this district and our superintendent. We pray for our community, our nation, and our world in these troubled times. We pray for all the people and places who are in need. God, we pray for an end to this coronavirus and political healing in our own country. God, we pray for men and women who serve us at home and abroad. We pray for our world leaders at every level. We pray for ourselves, our families, our church, our community, our nation, and the whole world, the blessings of peace, justice, health, safety, freedom, stability, prosperity, and holiness. And now, God, we pray that you would hear the prayers of each and every heart that is here this morning and those that are joining us online as we offer up to you our prayers, either silently or aloud, saying, in Jesus' name, amen. Thank you. Loving God, you've heard our prayers here this morning, and you hear the prayers remain silent in our hearts. God, you know our every need, and we do not know how to pray. Your Spirit intercedes for us with groanings that are too deep for words. And God, we pray that you hear us now as we lift our voices together in the prayer which our Savior has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And now I invite you to stand and join me in professing our faith in words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven, is seated at the right hand of the Father, and will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
If you stay sane.
I will sing down.
benediction. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord, and may the blessings of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit go with you now and remain with you always. Let us go into the world to make disciples of Jesus Christ, experiencing grace, exploring truth, expressing love. Amen.
Daddy.